Though I have to say goodbye, remember me. Don't let it make you cry, for even if I'm far away, I hold you in my heart. I sing a secret song to you each night we are apart. Remember me. Though I have to travel far, remember me. Each time you hear a sad guitar, know that I'm with you the only way that I can be. Until you're in my arms again, remember me.
Is this on? Yeah, there we go. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jane Castleman. I'm today's service associate. Along with Kat Barnett and Bob Koches, we'll be presenting our message this morning. Our opening words this morning are by Marilyn Falkowski. We welcome you. We know you come here for different reasons, to find community, to seek your spiritual and personal truths, to question, to nurture your heart and soul, to be nurtured, to explore new ideas, to find comfort, and perhaps find the answers to some of your bigger questions. We welcome you. We know you come from different places, different religions, different beliefs, and different backgrounds. We hope you will find comfort, connection, challenge, and love here. We hope you will find ways to provide outreach to others in our fellowship, in our local community, and in our world community. And so I just want to welcome you with Life from Fellowship Hall. It's our LCUUF Sunday service. Our announcements were on a slideshow before the service and were also sent out with our weekly newsletter. If you're new and would like to receive that newsletter and other emails, please talk to a member of the welcome team or write to us at lcuuf.org. And now a special welcome to our visitors. If you're visiting with us for the first time or have returned after or reconnected with us after a long absence, we invite you to say your name and tell us where you're from. If you're on Zoom, please introduce yourself in the chat box. The service associate will read those messages aloud. We'll start with the people here in the room. Are there new members among us in the room? Not a one. Here we go.
I'm Jim. I'm here.
We need the microphone for the people on Zoom.
All right, you guys. I'm Jim, and I have a home here, and I have a home in Vegas. So I run back and forth a little bit. Thanks.
Welcome.
Another?
Anybody else?
No.
Are there others on Zoom, Kat?
Are there others on Zoom? You know, this is new technology, and Kat is having a little trouble, so so let me find them. All right, so here we are on Zoom, and the chat. There is one thing on the chat. Let me look at it. All right. Good morning. I'm Wendy Fox, Bob and Kathy Koch's daughter.
Anybody else? Nope. Okay. So welcome to all our visitors and newcomers, both in person and on Zoom. And just a brief note, We offer a wide variety of services on various topics, presented by our members, outside guests, and our minister, Reverend Matt Alspaugh. So we hope you will return to sample this variety of thought and belief. So our chalice lighting words today are by S. William Feiss and are adapted. We light this flame. Yeah, your turn, sorry.
As our fervent plea to brighten the dark corners of our hearts,
we hold this flame.
For it is the promise of warmth for souls grown cold in loss and despair.
We kindle this light.
That we might continue to find comfort in its warmth, strength in its light, holiness in its presence.
We follow this light.
That it might illuminate our search for purpose, for meaning, and for forgiveness.
We light this chalice.
Knowing, even as the sacred sparks of our lives will one day be extinguished, then, in the ensuing darkness, these embers, our lights, will yet flare and burn bright with all the memory and hope of our lives.
We light this flame of life, of love, and truth for the divine promise of healing hearts.
Now, let us light our chalice with these words that we sing together.
Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. The sharing of joys, sorrows, and milestones is one way that we practice holding one another in community. Please note, this is not the time to announce upcoming events, things for sale, political messages, and so on. Those can be distributed in other ways, such as in the written announcements that run before the service or on our LCUUF Facebook page. So right now we speak briefly of what is in our hearts, sharing any significant personal joys or sorrows in our lives, because there is power in the sharing. We will start with the folks in the room to give those on Zoom a chance to type joys or sorrows into the chat to be read aloud by the service associate. First, let us recall the joys. Whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others, are there any joys that people would like to share here in the room?
Yes, I am Michael. I just returned from a blessed week with my 99-year-old mother and family. Great time. We had a wonderful, loving time. Thank you.
Oh.
This is Kate. I just got back a couple days ago from 2 weeks up north visiting family. I had a very good visit with a family, and I am so glad to be back here.
Sorry. Hi, I'm Phyllis, and my youngest son is coming tomorrow for a week's visit, and I'm really looking forward to it.
The joy I'd like to share. My name is John, but welcome, Skeena. And her first time at UU.
Okay.
Wait.
Oh, here's Bob.
Bob.
I'm Bob Koches, and I have a great joy that my daughter's coming back down to visit me on next Saturday night.
Okay. Kat, are there joys on Zoom, Kat?
Are there joys on Zoom? All right. Let me look.
It's a new process here.
We have a couple of things. Lynn Cleek sends for my 72nd birthday today. My college roommate, again, this is Kat doing something new, all right, has come to visit for a few days. That possibly was last week, so let me go back. All right. I seem to remember that. And we have one from John Ward. Next Sunday, the 5th, my housekeeper, Rocio, and family will hold an Hermes to raise, I don't know how to pronounce that, to raise funds for her mother-in-law, who has, oh, this is a sorrow, but I guess I can go ahead and read it since I started, who has serious heart problems requiring tests and surgery. Her taquiza will open at 8 a.m. and stay open until they sell out. If you're in the area, please stop. That's Joni.
So now let's voice the others of the sorrows that maybe you may be holding here in the room.
My name is Sue. I would like to light a candle of sorrow for Ricky and Richard Martin, who arrived this week for a 3-week visit, and Richard immediately got COVID. So let's hold them in our hearts.
Hi, I'm Joni. This is more education than it is concern. The last comment that was on there about my sweet housekeeper, Rocio, and the kitza that they're having is more appropriately to be put in newsletters in the future, and I just want you to know that. It was not to be show up here. I was just trying to figure out where it goes, and it showed up everywhere.
Yeah.
We love you, Joni.
Okay, Kat, are there any more? No, I think
are
there are not.
Are there sorrows on Zoom? Let me look. And I don't believe there are any more, but okay. I can look again. My tablet is also old, and like a lot of old things, it's a little slow. Okay, that's it.
Okay. And this candle from our care team represents the joys and sorrows we hold in the silent sanctuary of our hearts. We light this candle for all those unspoken sorrows and joys. Let us share a moment of silence to hold in our hearts both the sorrows and the joys that have been shared this morning. So there are many ways to be of service to LCUUF. Our time, treasure, and talents, they're all necessary components to a healthy fellowship. Now is the time in our service when we ask you to share the gift of treasure through pledging and donations. Instructions for payments to the fellowship are on a slide during the announcements before the service every week. For the people here at the fellowship, we'll pass a basket. If you are new here today, or you are struggling to hold things together, let the basket pass you by. Your presence is more than enough, and is a gift to us. Each week, we give half the money collected at the service, a minimum of 5,000 pesos, usually more, to an organization providing services to our Lakeside community. For the month of October, we are supporting Poco a Poco, which helps people in the San Pedro Itzikan area. This organization supports youth and women in this indigenous area through education, teaching local organic food growth, providing food and drinking water to renal patients, feeding over 300 children 5 days a week, offering health services as well as literacy and English as a second language classes. One of the services they provide is feeding children and adults who are vulnerable to kidney disease. They now have 6 community kitchens in that area. If you're not attending the fellowship in person, please donate to Share the Basket when you pay your pledge. Donate to Share the Basket separately or indicate what part of your donation is for Share the Basket. The offering has now been generously given and gratefully received.
Okay. Our opening hymn is Spirit of Life. Please rise in body or in spirit and join us in singing.
Queremos Halloween. Queremos Halloween. Queremos Halloween.
I remember hearing that
for the first time a couple years ago.
I remember hearing that for the first time a couple years ago.
It was October 31st.
I moved to Mexico.
And not too long after I moved to a new neighborhood,
one with a lot more children.
Not too long after I'd moved to a new neighborhood.
I immediately realized it was Halloween and felt a little bit of embarrassment that I didn't have candy to hand out as I would have done up north. But also having been infused with the richness of Dia de los Muertos, I began to wonder, are we Northerners doing some kind of cultural colonization of Mexico with ideas like Halloween and trick-or-treat? Were we Northerners once again exporting a commercialized sugar-filled attraction to the rest of the world? This thought annoyed me. I've come to realize that the relationship between Halloween and Dia de los Muertos is a bit more complicated than that. You see, Halloween draws from the more ancient or the ancient Irish Celtic holiday of Samhain. It was a major holiday on the 1st of November, celebrating the harvest, with people dressing in costumes and attempting to appease the pagan gods with food and drink to assure that people and livestock would survive the winter. It was also a time when the veil between the world and this world and the other world became thin. And fairies roamed the night. Now don't think of Tinkerbell. These fairies were fearful creatures who often brought sickness and death. When the Catholic Church encountered the Celts, the Church did it what it often did, syncretizing them, that is, assimilating certain of the Celtic beliefs into Catholicism. So the Catholics took an existing feast day, All Saints Day, which then was celebrated in May, and moved it over to November 1st, dropping it on Samhain. So while the focus became the Catholic saints, rather than the dead in general, all the trappings of the festival, the bonfires, the feasting, costumes, gifts, all that continued. But most of our Halloween traditions are, in fact, much more recent. Consider the All Saints' Eve tradition of trick-or-treat. Trick-or-treat originally involved poor people going from house to house, offering to pray for the dead relatives of householders in exchange for food and drink. Later, rather than pray, some of these visitors would do tricks for food. These Irish traditions migrated with the Irish potato famine diaspora to the United States and Canada. But the trick-or-treat game became increasingly violent in the 1920s, with teenage boys setting up pranks, throwing rocks, setting fires, even dynamiting a school. Even towns in both the U.S. and Canada considered banning the holiday altogether. But many encouraged a more modern form where smaller children would beg for treats from neighbors or at Halloween parties. This holiday has continued to evolve. Commercialized as candy makers realized they could replace homemade treats, and as other businesses realized they could supply costumes and yard decorations for the masses. All for a profit. More recently, the holiday has become adult-oriented. Coors Beer was a key player, claiming Halloween as its own holiday, and hiring Elvira, that is, Cassandra Peterson, as their front woman. After all, you can sell a lot more stuff to adults than you can to children. The Dia de los Muertos is quite a different holiday than Halloween. And yet it has a history with some parallels to Halloween. The holiday is quite ancient, originating from Aztec traditions dating back thousands of years to Micahuitl, a harvest festival which also was a time of honoring the dead and inviting them to visit the living. The Spanish, specifically Catholic missionaries, moved this holiday to November 1st and 2nd, All Saints' Day and All Souls' Day, respectively. Again, the church was syncretizing these indigenous beliefs, mixing them with Christian beliefs, all to make Christianity more attractive as a replacement religion. Like Halloween, Dia de los Muertos has evolved to fit the times. Some of these traditions trace back to the Aztec times, others to medieval European elements brought over from Spain. And so both the Aztecs and the medieval Spanish had traditions about leaving food out for the nourishment of visitors from the dead. But parades are much more recent, traced to the James Bond movie Spectre, which included an elaborate Day of the Dead parade, resulting in the establishment of such parades in many cities. These changes suggest that Dia de los Muertos is evolving, and that bodes well for its future. Traditions that evolve survive. So both Halloween and Dia de los Muertos have somewhat parallel histories, having developed from indigenous cultures and then syncretized by the Catholic Church, becoming popular international holidays today. However, they do have differences in tone, in emotional valence. I think Halloween tends to dance around death, sanitizing it on the one hand rather than confronting death head on. If anything, when it does face death, Halloween draws from Calvinist Christian images of death, ghoulish and revolting, with its promise of a horrible end for most of us. The theme of Halloween is haunting, and it is about horror. It is terror, and it is about death as finality. I think Dia de los Muertos recognizes both the sadness and loss that death brings, but mixed in with a degree of joy in remembering our departed friends and family, and with humor, black humor certainly, as we reflect on the nature of death. Dia de los Muertos taps into the ancient indigenous belief in the cycle of life and death, offering a more complex and hopeful theme of connection with and remembrance of our dear departed ones who have gone on before us. Blessed be.
Today's reading is the legend behind the Sempasuchil. It began when two Aztecs, Xochitl and Huitzilin, were little. They used to play together.
And particularly enjoyed hiking to the top of a nearby mountain where they would offer flowers to the sun god
Tonatiuh.
When war broke out, the lovers were separated.
As Huitzilin headed to
fight and protect their homeland, and his death devastated Xochitl, and she decided to walk one last time to the top of the mountain and implore sun god Tonatiuh to somehow join her with Huitzilin, her love.
The sun god was moved by her prayers and threw a ray that gently touched the young girl's cheek.
She turned into a beautiful flower of fiery colors as intense as the sun's rays.
And suddenly a hummingbird lovingly touched the center of the flower with its beak.
It was Huitzilin
that was reborn as a handsome hummingbird.
The flower gently opened its 20 petals, filling the air with a mysterious and lovely scent.
The lovers would always be together.
As long as Sempasuchil flowers and hummingbirds existed on Earth.
Good morning. I'm going to start with a personal statement. I started this exercise 4 months ago as a reflection of empathy and what it means to lose someone. To experience grief and loneliness. It was part of a meditation I was doing. I did not realize at the time it would become so real with the passing of my wife. So this is a reflection not only about the head, but about the heart and the joining of them two together. When you lose someone, especially a loved one, there's a hole in your heart that can never be filled. At the same time, there is a wholeness that has been lost. It is meaningful. And it hurts. Don't let anyone ever tell you that sadness departs or the hurt ever goes away. It doesn't. All you can do is to live life. You, you minister, Greta Crosby, author of Tree and Jubilee, says it much better than I can say. When we lose someone dear to us, someone who is part of our daily lives, the fabric of life feels deeply torn. It may continue to feel torn for a long time. Yet, as we inch forward, we inevitably begin to weave new patterns. We pick up remaining old threads. Gather in the threads of support from our communities and spin new ones from fresh experiences and from our own growth. Somehow, even when we did not believe it possible, we each, the shuttle of our loom of our own lives, keep weaving and new patterns emerge. Any grief also connects us to every other loss we carry. Some of the losses we may have been well mourned and stayed ready to welcome a new loved one into the company of cherished memories. Others may have left wounds that are not fully healed by time. The pain of those can be newly intensified. Still others may have been sealed up without healing at all.
leaving us unaware of buried suffering that was never comforted. As we struggle to cope, a new tear in the fabric of our accustomed lives, there are perils and opportunities. Some of the time, we must just soldier on, cope with settling the estate, paying the bills, mowing the lawn, and caring for others and ourselves as best we can. But if we only soldier on, only stay positive because that is what our loved one would want, only keep chin up and eyes on the horizon, we will miss the chance to hold and comfort ourselves, the chance to grow through our grief, developing deeper compassion for ourselves and others, renewing our awareness of how sacred life is, including our own. Unquote. One of the things I didn't realize, but have come to realize, is that we do not share this loss separately or by ourselves. Other loved ones and friends all share in this loss. All have a feeling of emptiness that wasn't there before experiencing the loss. It is important to remember that other people hurting need to be comforted just as you need to be comforted. They too share your sadness. But they also share your joy and happy memories. You may find yourself doing busy work or watching them do busy work to avoid processing what has occurred. Periods of mourning, at least at times close to death, have clarity. There is a space made for feelings and tears, and times of hopes and stories, and for privacy. Rituals provide practical steps of survival to enter the non-linear time of grief. And remember the words of Ralph Waldo Emerson. For each thorn, there is a rosebud. For each twilight, there is a rosebud. A dawn. For each trial, the strength to carry on. For each storm, a rainbow. For each shadow, the sun. For each parting, sweet memories when sorrow is done. One truth I've learned over the decades is that no one is truly gone so long as they are remembered. The good that they did and the joy they provided remain behind in our lives and continue to provide us with the energy and the will to move forward. That's the one thing I really love about Mexican Day of the Dead celebration. They have the right idea. If you remember the video from Coco, the song Remember Me, or Recuerdo Me, it wasn't sad. It was joyous. It was fun. It was a fiesta. It is the whole concept that our loved ones have not left us, but are here. And every year, we gather together and enjoy their favorite foods and tell their stories. It is one of the bright lights of Mexican tradition that we enjoy living here. So today, may we live stories of honor and admiration. May we share gratitude generously. And may we embody kindness in our relationship with those who have died, in our relationship with those who live. Our dead should know they will be honored and remembered here in the congregation long after they have left. They should know that at least once a year, their name will be evoked, their memory will be held. Their stories will be shared. Taking comfort in the knowledge and resting in the inevitability that their life will return to the congregation heart each year is part of what can help make a death good. I also like and love the idea that no one is really dead until the last person with the last memory of the loved one is dead. I love the tradition of the offerenda altar to help keep those memories alive. Did you notice all the marigolds in the fellowship as you came in? These blooms are used to decorate the altar to the dead with their bright orange color and strong scent. They are thought to help guide the spirits of the dead home. They have been around since ancient times with their Naotel name, Sempasoschil, meaning 20 flowers. And of course, when you're preparing the offerenda, don't forget the tequila. Let us now, in the Mexican tradition of Day of the Dead, celebrate the collective lives of our lost friends and keep their stories alive as we watch the slides of our departed friends. Thank you.
A ritual of remembrance. A ritual of remembrance.
We now enter into a time of reflection.
We now enter into a time of reflection, of remembrance of those who have left us,
who have left
a time to bring forth in our minds their memories,
to bring forth in all the complexities and beauty of their lives,
in all the complexities and
during this time of silence, you are invited to come
on the front aisle,
you are invited
and silently light a candle of remembrance
and silently light a candle behind the remembrance.
And if you're on Zoom, you can type light a candle in chat.
And if you're on Zoom,
and Jane or Kat
light
a candle,
light a candle for you.
And Jane or Kat will light a candle for you.
May all these lives today be blessed by our remembrance.
May all these lives today be blessed
by
our remembrance.
May we remember them in love.
May our lives too
be filled.
May our
with
lives
love's blessings
be filled.
Amen.
With love's blessings.
Amen.
Our closing hymn is Blessed Spirit of
Our
My Life.
Our closing hymn is
Please
blessed,
rise
blessed
in body or in spirit
life.
And join us in
Please
singing.
Please rise in body or in spirit and join us in singing.
This earth but a brief moment in time.
We walk this earth but a brief
amid our
moment
suffering
in time.
And pain,
however great
amid our suffering
or small,
and pain,
however
let us
great
continue to learn
small,
how to celebrate life.
Let us continue to learn how to celebrate
Let us continue
life.
To grow in our capacity to
let
love ourselves.
Let us continue to grow
and
in
each
our
other.
Capacity to love ourselves.
And let us continue other. To move toward the goal of a
and
just
let us
world
continue
community.
To move toward the goal of a just world.
Go this day in a renewed spirit of peace and
go
hope.
This day in a renewed spirit
and with
of
the
peace
wisdom
and
to
hope.
Greet
and with
the new
wisdom
week.
To greet the new week.
Let us extinguish our chalices with these words, which we read together.
Let us extinguish our chalices with these words.
We extinguish this flame. Together. Let not the light of truth.
Extinguish this flame.
The warmth of community.
Not the light of truth.
Or the fire.
The warmth
of community.
These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world. And share with all the world.
We're going to close the service with a traditional we're going to close Mexican the folk song with a traditional is particularly Mexican folk song at this time is particularly of year. The story is very macabre. The story is very macabre. Stands for the wailing La or the weeping woman stands for the wailing and or the weeping as woman. Legend and folklore goes and as she legend discovered and folklore goes her husband she discovered in bed with her another husband man. And in then bed promptly with another murdered man. Her two children or drowned and then them. Promptly murdered her two children no. or drowned them.
Another woman.
Sorry?
No?
Did I say a man? Sorry? Did I say a man? Well, it could have been. Well, it could have been. Yes, I stand corrected. Yes. I and she drowned corrected. In a fit of Pete drowned her and she two drowned children in a fit of and was drowned her to for eternity, and to was walk destined waters for eternity, wailing to walk for waters what she had done. And this was told, the story was told done. To and this was children told by their parents to prevent to them from going children out by in the parents dark to prevent them from going out the river. In the dark and walking things alongside we should the never river. Do. So I'd like you, as I play it, I would like you to join in singing as I play it. I would like you to join in singing. And if you can't sing in Spanish or you don't really recognize the tune, don't really recognize the tune, just sing to La. It always works.
Go in peace, and with a purpose. Begins. Go in peace, and with a purpose.